call this meeting to order at 6:03. First thing to do, I'd like to have Bob Decker and possibly Bill Smith and maybe Mary talk about Betty Hollingsworth, and followed by a moment of silence, so please.
I'm sorry.
You guys start.
Betty Hollingsworth first went to work when Frontier came into existence, I believe. She did it all from home initially, correct?
Yep, that's correct.
Yes, and there was no computers or anything else. She did everything from her house. She had her own home office and what. It took for a long time for the central office to actually come about. She was a business manager for years, treasurer for years, and I fought with her on a regular basis. But she was a great person.
When I came here as a student in the late 60s, she was working in the office upstairs in the old junior high, the building that isn't there anymore. Her and Mrs. Bleakley were the people working in the office. And then after I went through school, I came up here to the school committee, and she became the business manager, and she was the treasurer and the bookkeeper. She used to come up those stairs to the meetings in the conference room. She'd be carrying that pile of warrants. It was like this big. She'd be lugging that thing up the stairs every single meeting, put it in the back of it. Because everything was done by hand, by paper, you know. And she gave about 40 years to the district before she retired. And she wasn't any less active after she retired than she was before. But she was part of the Frontier family for a good 40 years.
She was also one of the petitioners that sued Frontier relative to the one man, one vote.
That was driven by the mascot. But that's...
And her passing date? When did she pass?
Friday.
I believe she was 86 years old. She also took over the class reunions because my mom was in her class, Helen Cornstead, and she would find you and she would search you out. There's no social media. There's no come if you can. She would come and she would come to your house and she would do a lot of talking and you would go to the class reunion.
She ran the blind ski program at Mount Tom for years and years and years. All those street signs that you see in Deerfield that have the name of Veteran Down. She was the driving force behind those street signs being put up. I mean, Betty was, she was still lifeguarding, for God's sakes, and she was in her 70s, late 70s and early 80s. She was still.
I'd like to add that even though I've only been here, this is my fifth year, Mrs. Hollingsworth has been our institutional memory. And just recently as last year, we contacted her to help us research if there ever was a union agreement that existed. And she went back in her files. And so anytime we had a question about like what was happening, she was still right there to take our calls. And she'd stop by the office at least once a year. And she was a lovely, lovely woman.
Class lady.
So that said, I would like to ask for a moment of silence. Thank you. Okay, moving along, presentation, Mayor Superintendent.
I'm very, very pleased to present to you the 2017 Superintendent's Award recipient, Jonathan Daly. And I just want to say how pleased and proud I am of Jonathan. I was able to, being new and not knowing a lot of the students and or families, I really didn't have a lot to go on except that I love students. I've worked with students for over 25 years. High school, I've been a high school guidance counselor for many years. And so it doesn't take long to get to know what a person is about. I asked three people in the building to each select one person, so that I would have a real balanced selection. And so I asked the guidance director, I asked Mr. Dredge, and I asked Mr. Modesto. And so Jonathan was one of the three, and I was able to spend quite a bit of time with all of them. And believe me, they are all wonderful. This school has the most awesome group of students I really had the pleasure to hang around with. And more to the point, I'm excited to be able to be in the building, to be able to see them on a regular basis. These students are fantastic. But what struck me about Jonathan, and forgive me if you've heard this before, was his work ethic. Jonathan is a senior. He's graduating. He's interested in engineering. His role model was his grandfather, who is a materials engineer, has helped develop materials for NASA, has spent his career at UMass Amherst in the mechanical engineering department. Jonathan was the recipient of the Rensselaer Polytechnic Institute Award, Book Award, the medal. And he is also has taken 6 AP classes. That's pretty amazing. His current GPA is 4.17. I'm just blown away. He works summers on local farms. He is involved in, well, he has been involved in band. He's involved in football, baseball. I'm doing this from memory now. Track. And also some plays. He's done several plays, and he excels in mathematics. He does not love the humanities as much, but he's also quite good in the humanities. The thing that really struck me, though, was his, on top of all of that, one of the things that had the most impact on him was his volunteer. He volunteers at the Greenfield Senior Center, and as you well know, our population, I was born in the 50s, we are aging, and geriatrics is becoming quite a thing. We're doing so much more research, and we're learning so much more about older adults, and to be able to have someone young be so interested in older adults and spending time volunteering, I think is amazing. He's also a member of National Honor Society. You're the treasurer of
National Honor Society.
Are you a student council? You name it, Jonathan's done it. We're proud to have him in our school, and he's really taken the best that we have to offer, and he's made a great deal of, he has made quite a bit of accomplishment out of all the opportunities that we can offer here at Frontier. So I'm very pleased to recognize Jonathan. Thank you.
Sorry, it's more money.
I'm 6'2".
Yeah, he's not much, though.
We can maybe run football at our place. Yeah. Go through.
Thank you, Ms. Walden.
Good morning.
Congrats.
Congratulations.
You'll have a fine future.
Congratulations. Congratulations.
It's after mom.
Well, be no thanks to you now.
Thank you.
It usually gets outside, right?
Congrats, Dad. Congrats.
Yeah. Good job.
He will have a wonderful career. He will be very successful, though, as many and all of our graduates will be.
Thank you. Review and approve minutes of November 8th, 2016. Do you have any comments, changes? Just to reiterate that we have changed our calendar. We no longer have a meeting in January, and it's been moved to the 24th. Sorry, January 10th. It's been moved to January 24th, so our budget subcommittee can meet if they want again. We're more comfortable with that. And then also, we had decided to give ourselves an additional meeting of February 28th if it was necessary, and if it's not necessary, we will just cancel that one. Just so everybody knows, that was printed up really well, too. Good job.
I'd like to make a motion to approve the minutes as is.
Second.
Any other discussion? All those in favor? Anybody have to abstain? One abstention. Okay. Public comment? No problem. We have no reports, we have no unfinished business, and we are moving on to new business.
Did we forget me?
Excuse me?
Did we forget me?
Where's, oh, jeez, I checked you off, Patty, I apologize.
Well, I'm here, but...
It was a good report.
It was brief.
Financial statement. It was very brief, yeah. Maybe that's a hint.
It was so quick, you missed it. So tonight, you're signing 23 warrants in the total amount of $1,958,581.54. Those were all sent out to you. We, if you would recall, when our last gas bid was, we went out to bid, the collaborative that we were going out with had fallen apart because the city of Springfield pulled out and we were all on our own. That left us in a bit of a problem because Frontier didn't have assigned capacity with Berkshire Gas. So we, for this year, went with Berkshire Gas to get the assigned capacity. And now that we did that, we got some fresh pricing today, and we can lock in with Direct Energy for 36 months at .474 per cubic foot, is that how I say it? Currently, we're paying .532. So we can lock in for 36 months, but I have to sign in tomorrow. They're only good for 24 hours.
36 months?
Pardon?
3 years?
Yes.
Have we ever done...
Yeah, we've always done 3, 5 years.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. This is the only time we've been solo because we had to get the assigned capacity stature.
If you can buy anything cheaper this year than you bought it last year, you better buy it.
The new one will be what?
47.4.
And for the next 2 years?
For 3 years.
We can predict the cost.
So what will that save us?
Lower our gas costs.
I know that, but what...
I don't know what we're currently...
Quite to a dollar.
There's an app for that.
Well, I don't have our capacity. I don't know what we've been using. I mean, it's hard with the different winters. Last year, we had a mild winter. This year, it could be a colder winter. So I have not, I don't have a...
Those burners are convertible, right?
Was that...
Those are convertible, right? They could burn either source?
Yes.
Yeah, we haven't burned oil for a long time. And in fact, one of these years, I'd like to burn the tank down and refill it. But, you know, the economics haven't really looked well. But in the next year or two, we either really ought to burn that down or bring somebody in to treat it because it's been stored underground for quite a long time.
So we did do the comparison last year when we could not get a, when we could not deal out with the big bid. We did do the comparison of how much fuel, how many gallons we'd have to burn. And it was like an excess of 20,000 gallons to make out with the price of 57 cents, 53 cents. But we do have that issue. Bob and I have both been told because that oil's been in the ground so long, it may not be worth burning. So we're going to have to get it tested before we burn.
Well, it's worth burning, but the longer we keep it there, the more we're just going to have issues with the quality of what we're burning and getting it through the burners and that. There's a lot of oil in the ground there. We've got to burn.
What kind of additive have we put in it? Any?
We haven't done much of anything. We've had it tested once or twice and it's been okay. But we're not putting an additive in it or anything.
But how much time do you need to switch over from one to the other?
Well, that's a good question because in all the time I've been here, it's almost automatic. It's supposed to be. But I have a great deal of anxiety about doing it. I've talked at several occasions with Jamrock, the people that are doing most of our heating system maintenance. And, you know, they tell me it's pretty simple, but I'd like to see it happen more.
Can we try it out over a long weekend or something like that? I don't suggest we do it while we're moving to the superintendent's office, but, you know, maybe sometime in February, school vacation, maybe?
That's probably a good idea, just burn a little. Not enough to make a financial impact on what we're buying or keeping, but just burn enough to see.
Well, I want to make sure we do it when we don't screw the works up, so to speak.
Yeah, I think that might be a good idea.
School's shut down.
Anybody else think that that's not a good idea in the middle of the winter? Leave well enough alone until spring?
Well, by the time, what I'm thinking is it's not going to happen over the winter break because we're moving central.
Right.
So it would probably happen during the February. It's already getting a little bit warmer then, and just a short you know, what I would not want to do is wait so long we couldn't do it at all. So I would say February, March might be exactly the time to do it.
I feel better having a good share of the year behind us, just in case.
Just getting back to the bid for the oil, Patty, could you just, the vendor that you heard, I never heard of that company.
Direct Energy?
I don't follow it.
This is the first year we haven't been with them. We've been with them for a very long time. I don't know anything more than that. I'm not well versed in utilities. I came from a school district whose municipality owned its own gas and electric, and they took care of all that. So I don't know direct from Constellation, from just all big energy companies that are out there. Sprague was the other one that submitted a bid today.
What was their price?
I can't get into my email now, so I don't know what's going on here.
In light of your concerns about, you know, running one of the boilers and maybe we have two boilers. Either one of the two can pretty much handle the load in the school.
Mm-hmm.
So if we decided to try to convert them over to gas, we could do them one at a time. So if we had a problem, we could just default.
Yeah, that's my point.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you. It's my job.
Right,
so do we have to take a vote on that, or is that just something?
Well, you can, because I'm going to be locking us in for 3 years, so.
Can I ask? I mean, it would be helpful to know what the other bid was.
Okay, and for some reason, I just got locked out of my computer, and I can't get back in.
Was it higher?
Yeah, they were all higher.
So we took the lowest bid?
This was the lowest bid.
Okay.
They were all higher.
And who was the company?
Direct Energy.
Do we have to put that up a bit?
Direct Energy came in.
No, we just need to, that's what.
Yeah.
We use a whatchacallit, a vendor, LP Bank.
So I move that we lock in the price for $1.474 for a 3-year period.
Can you give me that number again?
$1.474.
No, .474.
Please don't lock it at 1.4.
All right.
Okay, Sprague was .5340. Direct was .4740.
I wrote down one in front of each one of them, so I don't know why.
And Constellation did not bid this time. Constellation bid on Friday at .6730.
Wow.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Sorry about the glitch.
Do I have a second?
Second.
All those in favor?
And then the last thing I have to report is that I checked on November 29th with Terry Williams at the Department of Revenue to see where our E&D certification was, and they are behind. They're busy with the towns who had to have rates for fall meetings, and he's hoping he'll get it to me by the end of this month.
We're going to need that before we finish the budget.
The towns have to have their E&D certified so that they can set their tax rates and everything else. So they're first, and they're busy because they were rated with the early retirement too, so they got all new staff. So they're running behind. It's never, in the years I've been here, it's never taken this long. I usually get it within a 2-week turnaround.
Hmm. Did they give you any kind of date?
He said by the end of the month.
Anyone else?
Got some questions on that.
You got questions? Go for it.
Right now, we're getting several different accounts that are in the negative by a large percentage, and some of it has to do with the fact that they're reallocating the accounts in one area where in the past things were charged in certain places. And the other thing is we're getting some additional expenses from some new collective bargaining initiatives that are now being paid for. And I just want to know, overall, are we going to have sufficient monies to cover the deficits and where they are? And what have you? In the past, we always have, but one particular account, expense other instructional software.
What page are you on?
On page 4, $573.25%. increase in expenses, and I don't know what it is, but that one's the big one that sticks out. And my question is, you know, is Is there any more coming?
Was it 500%? Is it 500% of $1,000, or is it 500%?
It's big. The budget was
500% means nothing to me.
The budget was $2,980, and $20,000 has been charged there. So that is definitely not looking right. So I will check into that and get back to you.
I didn't go through this in great depth, but
even though I sent it to you a week ago.
I looked at it today, and then I decided I better get a printed copy so I could at least act and tell.
Can't you look at it on your little screen there now?
I can, but that can't print it up, can't circle it. There's no ability to sit there and highlight what you want to talk about.
That's when you get a piece of paper, pad, line number, blah, blah, blah.
We're all paperless. We're trying to stay away from that.
Good job, Bob.
Right, but he wants me to print it out, so we're not going paperless.
Well, that's my point. My other point is, when you guys are talking about doing the budget and what have you, I understand there's an accounting system that can be used that will scan everything, and somebody has to do the work to scan the stuff. What's the name of your software?
Infinite Visions. We don't have that. I told you we don't have the module to do that.
But my point is, can we pay for the module so we have it? So when you email this stuff to each board member with the warrants and everything else, they can click on it, they can see all the details behind it, so that they're not operating in a vacuum.
So first of all, we have a plan as to the modules that we're adding to Infinite Visions, and I think our first one is to get our purchase orders live before we go to scanning invoices. I think that's more important to give us a better control over our budget, that we're accounting for it as we spend, not after the fact. So that's our first goal. Our second goal is also to go green, and we are going to start doing that with our direct deposits. We're no longer printing those out. Those will get emailed to our employees. But the scanning of the invoices is part of the bigger conversation that we need to have when we talk about the storage of invoices. So that conversation I've put off with Scott Paul as to how, going forward, do we stop the massive file cabinets sitting at 219 Christian Lane? And that means buying a large file server so that we can take the scans of all these invoices. The second piece is, if I ever tried to email you those files, they would be so huge, all your emails would blow up. I doubt your server, your carriers would even accept those size files. There are limits to the size of email files that you can send. So I think that would be problematic.
Well, I like to make sure that, you know, we can link into it. When you send that, and if we want to go back and review it, that we can actually link into the system with a password, reach to one of the board members, so they actually look at these invoices once we buy this particular program, because we really need to have hands-on as to what our responsibilities are. And, you know, I don't know what it costs to buy this.
Didn't we just set up a subcommittee to do that?
We did, and then the
Are you the subcommittee?
Yes, he is.
Yeah. Well, I'm just one person.
I think your responsibility is there to make and set policy and to hire and fire the superintendent.
Well, this is policy as to reviewing the cost.
I think this sounds like a perfect matter for your subcommittee to take up.
I think everything you said is pretty cool down the road. I think it sounds like Patty and her people, I didn't want to say your people, but
staff.
your staff, that they do have a plan of action, and I'm good with that. But as you said, we have a group to look at that, and I think we're going to leave it as that. However, thank you for bringing that up, because I too would love to click on something and have all that background information, but at the same time, I don't want my emails blowing up.
Oh,
so
I don't either.
Possibly down the road we can do that. That's a really good, perfect world. Yes, Mr. Modesto?
I was wondering to answer this question, and Patty, you can confirm or deny. I believe that expense that you're talking about, that the overage there is PowerSchool. It's the only thing we spent that much money on for software.
Is that was last year, so that's not
we even the trainings and stuff.
Yeah, we encumbered all that last year. They gave us a Warren article to do it. They gave us money last year from E&D. No, I'm explaining.
Yes, I'm just trying to think. The only thing we spent that much money software wise is on PowerSchool and PowerSchool instruction.
Well, then it's reclassed wrong, and I will look into it.
Maybe it could pay out of this year's budget, and it should have come out of encumbered funds.
Well, I was hoping that was going to be the quick solution.
Well, the good news is, came up. Find it.
Well, that's my point. Is, right. You know, I think that we need to have hands on as to where their money's being spent, and so we can click on it. I'm not saying we should have the ability to change anything, but I think we should have the ability.
Oh, no, you're not saying that.
The ability to review the details.
So we're going slow to go fast. So when I started, one of the things I asked Patty, and she agreed and was able to do it, was to make sure that you had these financials at least 48 hours before the meeting, so that you could actually look at them and question and come up with questions, and that we can deal with them in real time at the meeting. We're really excited. I asked her last week about the employees that the regional district has for direct deposit. That even though we do direct deposit, we're still printing out their pay stubs, and we're still folding them and putting them in envelopes and putting a little, you know, scotch tape on them, and then having someone bring them and deliver them. Those will now be delivered through the mail, and that's a big step. I mean, so we're going slow. We're making movement towards paperless, but we need to add on each layer slowly. So this is a really big thing, and this will save money. This will save effort. It'll save cost on employees, the printing, and everyone will have their pay stub right in their email. They'll have an attachment in their email. And when your bank opens on Friday, thus and so, your check in this amount will be available for you.
Maybe it's just me, but I have absolutely no interest in looking at 50 pounds of invoices for toilet paper, paper napkins, and pencils. Financial statement, I look at it, but I have zero interest in looking at a pile of invoices this deep. So if you do come up with a way to email it to me, please don't.
I think both sides of that are true, but I think you should have the option. But I think, as you said, it's down the road. So good job so far, and keep up the good work, and let's move on.
So I do have the answer to that. It's the virtual high school for $11,250 that's causing that line to go over.
Why did that go up so much this year compared to what was budgeted?
I don't think we pulled it from last year.
Right. We did what?
Probably didn't budget.
So it's virtual high school, it's the option, so everybody knows what it is. We allow 15 slots for students to take online classes anywhere through virtual high school, which is like the Kleenex of facial tissue. So there's a lot of virtual high schools out there. This is the virtual high school. And so they can take anything from AP courses we don't offer. They can take German. They can take any classes that we don't offer at our school.
Well, we've done this before.
We've done this last.
So where was it before?
That's what I have to find out. Because now they're correctly, wherever it was before was incorrect. So where it's supposed to be is other instructional softwares. So that is the correct bucket.
So we are.
But before, we would stick it in a line that had $11,000
available.
So there
must be some line item somewhere that's 500%.
Correct. So that's what I have
to do.
I have to go back to the previous year and see where we charged it.
Okay, we set?
Yes.
I like the way you think.
We are moving along.
It's been here a long time.
Okay, we're on new business. Yes. We can, because he is.
Yeah.
We could even if he was.
Oh, you're.
And he's been sitting here for a while.
And he's been so kind.
Let's let him go.
So long range, Bob, you're on.
Okay. The first sheets I'm going to hand out here are something you've all saw pretty much once before. I spent a lot of time this year. I've already, two of the elementary schools presented the budget, and the longer range budget, in the same format that I gave it to this group last year. I used that as a model, so everyone's kind of working on the same thing. One of the things I want to say as I hand this out is, and I wish I had talked a little more about this at the first two meetings where I handed it out, is I'm discovering, and I heard a discussion earlier tonight that really reinforced that in my mind, that there are projects that are too small for the operating, for the capital budget, but way too big for the operating budget. You don't want to put them in the operating budget every year, because we don't need that kind of money in the operating budget. But there's a lot of projects that are in the $10,000 to $50,000 range that need doing, and there's no really good, neat slot to put them in. I mean, somewhere I used to work, we had a budget that we called replacement renewal. That was that sort of thing. What I did with this budget this year is the same thing I did last year. I've got all of the things lined out in things that I think ought to be taken care of very soon, and then things that are in a 2 to 5 year range, and then things that are in a 5+ year range. And, you know, last year we got a lot of that money and we did a lot of good stuff. This year there's another big block of projects. There's a lot of things we can discuss. If they all don't get funded, it's not the end of the world, but every year that we defer the problems, they just get bigger and bigger and bigger. So here, those are the sheets. Again, I took off the projects we got done last year. I fine-tuned a few things and I added some things. And the first question everyone's gonna have is how much of those ones in red that I'd like to see done this year are gonna cost. And I've got those pretty well priced out. And while those are going around, I'll apologize to everybody for the smell you're being exposed to tonight. We're getting on the home stretch of moving the offices from Central here into this building. So we've got somebody downstairs doing some painting, and it's epoxy paint. It does smell.
Yeah, we're all a little loopy by the end of the night tonight.
And I'd like to thank Bob. If anyone has had a lot of pressure on them this season and coming right up into this month and the next 2 weeks, it's Bob Lesko. I've asked him to go to every school, work with every principal, come up with 1 to 5 year plans with every principal. Meanwhile, we have lost a couple of custodians. We've had to hire custodians. We've had some unusual things happening over in Deerfield in a kindergarten classroom, which we're all taking care of. And now the move, which Bob has been working steadily on since September, and the phone systems and all the electricity drops, the electrical drops, the office modulars. I'm excited for you to see it. Maybe next month we can take a tour. It's going to be quite nice. But meanwhile, every time I talk to Bob, I'm just adding. You know, every time I call, I'm so amazed that he answers my phone calls, because it's every day and it's something I need him to do. So thank you, Bob.
So if everyone's so inclined, I can go through the list of projects that I've listed that I'd like to talk about for this year. And also we can talk about any of the other projects that you see on the list and may or may not have questions about. The first item on my list is to purchase another piece of floor cleaning equipment. When I came here, we had a lot of stuff that was bought when the last major renovation was done. It was part of it budgeted in. They bought all new equipment, and everything's just getting to the end of its useful life. We've been using a newer auto scrubber, which is a square vibrating pad. It does a really great job. It's a great machine. I'd like to pick up another one of those this year. The skylight, the LNC is going to come up in a couple of discussions tonight. Darius would like to do some work in here, and he's got some money to redo some of the finishes, and I have issues of varying problems with the envelope here. The most primary problem I have is the clear story window there. Look at it from the outside, you can see the gaskets are falling out of the window. That this whole section of roof and that glass were part of the original 1952 building. They were not done over during the renovation. So I bought greenfield glass in. They really need to take that glass out with a crane and then redo the gaskets and reset it. you know, the one thing they did tell me that was good, you know, when we first saw the gaskets falling badly, there was some concern that the glass might be secure. They said the glass is secure, there's no danger of it falling. But we've had leaks up there, and a lot of it depends on which way the rain is coming and which way the wind is blowing, but the leaks can get pretty severe. And I don't really think we should wait another year or for a larger project before we deal with those gaskets and get those windows resealed. Painting the exterior trim is a lot. The primary place is if you walk in the middle school entrance and look at the overhangs there, you'll see those are peeling really badly. And they need to be scraped down and repaired, and it's just a big painting project. Replacing metal toilet partitions, that's approximately, that number would, I think, allow me to do about a third of the school. And again, those partitions are getting to a point where they're scratched pretty badly, but a lot of them also have become loose, and you know, they're just not in good shape. They take a lot of abuse from the kids. We did one of them over last year, and it came out really, really well. So what I'd like to do is just start a program where, at least for the next couple of cycles, we're replacing those. The vinyl repair, replace vinyl on stair treads, we got that amount last year. I figure this would allow us to do the second out of five. I'll be honest with you, the money that we've got this year hasn't been spent yet. We're going to probably spend that during February break or sometime in the spring. But there's five staircases in the building. Two of them are three-story, and then the rest of them are two-story. So I feel this chunk of money will let me do the second out of five. And if you look at the stair treads in some of the main corridors, they're big, heavy vinyl stair treads, and the nosings on some of them are worn to a point where they're tripping hazard. So it's a program that I really think we should continue on with. The money I'm asking for controls in the unit ventilators, that's a block of money we've gotten for about 3 or 4 years now. The good news is I think I can 100% finish that portion of the upgrade. It will take care of all our HVAC stuff, but the project that we've been doing with that money, which is to take the pneumatic actuators out of the unit ventilators and replace them with electronic, will pretty much finish up. And the difference in the classrooms when we do that project is night and day. We've had a lot of problems with overheating in classrooms and lack of control, and this has allowed us to deal with that. Carpet upgrades. We haven't done much carpeting at all in the time that I've been here, and again, it's most of the carpeting in this building is original to the 98 renovation. So, you know, I figure I did just a quick match back of the paper calculation, and I figured there's about 24,000 square feet of carpeting in this building. At $6 a square foot, that would be $250,000 worth of flooring. What I'm saying is I think it's time we start chipping away at that and spending some money. Most of it's in good shape. We do a good job of maintenance. Some of it's getting a little worn in places, and some of it's getting stained. But I think it's time we start doing a yearly project to upgrade our carpeting. The temperature alarm in the walk-in cooler freezer. The high school is the only freezer I have in the district now that doesn't have an alarm on it. And we've got a good amount of money invested in the food that's fed in the freezer, and you know, going like this summer, that thing was jam-packed full because we moved all of Deerfield stuff over here while we were doing the envelope project there. So basically, that would be just a temperature monitor that will have an auto dialer on it and calls and specify numbers if we lose a compressor or something or have a problem with the cooling there. Design study LMC upgrades. This is a topic, it's a big discussion. I put it in here. We'll probably discuss it a little later on in the meeting. But again, we've got to decide at some point what we're going to do in regards to the library. The metal roof on this portion of the building is getting pretty tired. It looks awful from, I was looking at it from the exposure in the back, the northern exposure, and it's just it's in really bad shape. We've got odds and ends of leaks all through the building here. It's a standing seam metal roof. I'm just not quite sure what needs to be done with that roof. I don't know if it needs to be scraped and painted and worked over, whether it needs to be sealed with something. But beyond the roof, we've got the issue I talked to you earlier about the glass. We've got issues with insulation at this roof before you get up into the area where the metal roof is. We've got a piece of air handling equipment in there that was original to the 1950s building. I think at some point we need to figure out where we're going with this part of the building. Yes?
I don't know where you get 1950. You mentioned 1952 earlier, yeah. Right? This addition and what have you was done in 1981.
Okay.
My history on this is not
deadly good.
But it's not the original.
I was looking at the 1998 drawings,
yep.
And it was saying most of this stuff was existing.
But nothing existed up here before that.
That's right.
This roof was on the cafeteria in New England. There was a roof.
It was a concave roof.
Like this.
And it leaked like a sieve.
You can't make this stuff up.
Yeah.
The roof went like this. And it started cracking and checking, and that's why we tore it off and built the media center.
Yeah.
It's good history that I don't have. In fact, I've got the one custodian that I have that worked in this building. I was picking his mind today, trying to find the history of, you know, where or when this section was last renovated.
Yeah, those windows and stuff, they maybe go back to the 81 to the
yeah, that's my,
media
that was
center
my
was
point.
Built, first media center.
So
but even so, if
yeah.
If they need to be fixed, we're going to have to fix them, yeah.
Still, it makes it some 35,
so
40 years old.
The question is that Bob is saying, do we wait and make it part of the, you know, the whole roof, or do we fix what's really going on now? Do we, so that the $25,000 is in there to study it, or do we wait until we take and get a bond project with the building authority?
And I think it's not something I'm saying absolutely has to be done, but I think it's prudent of me to tell you the problems that I see here, because every year that we don't deal with it, we're coming a little closer to having a crisis. I mean, there was, I believe, just prior to my coming here, in a windstorm, a good section of this roof peeled back, and they had to bring a crane in here and repair it. It's working. There's a lot of leaks here. I think the heat loss in this area it is a big issue. This is a very inefficient part of the building, and eventually we're going to have to figure out what to do with it. I'm bringing it up so you know it's there.
I don't think things like leaky roofs and so forth, though, even if you started tomorrow, you're 2 to 4 years away from a bond from being able to do anything on a grand scale.
Exactly.
You know,
so that's why
some
we're
of these
coming
just,
to you.
They do have the accelerated repair, and I guess that's what I talked to the MSBA today because their statement of interest isn't out yet, and they're going to be coming out January 6th. So they have an accelerated repair program, and then they have their core program. So I think that's what we have to figure out, is if we're going to go for just a roof of the entire building, or if we're going to go for something bigger, like a renovation of the entire building with windows, doors, handicap accessibility, everything. because that's, that would take longer. But at the accelerated repair program, now we did that last year this time, and the roof's on Deerfield already. So it is an accelerated repair program.
So, and I think we owe it to Mr. Lesko and operations to study what needs to be done, and maybe, because I have questions on, you know, why would we fix these windows if these windows are not the most efficient way to continue to have this building?
That's a good question. Yeah. Some of what, and there's all sorts of things driving the decision. I mean, one of the things that's going on right now is Darius has some money and that he'd like to spend. Like, he was given to the school.
We got the donation from Charles Mark there, that $35,000 that I don't want to put into infrastructure that's going to have water running on it.
Oh, boy.
You got to remember, last year we had to move the tables when the water was pouring in because the computers were on the tables. Right. And then you're looking at every one of these tables that are falling apart. I mean, you wiggle your wiggle your butt right now.
That was going to be my question. How bad do the chairs have to get before they make their way to the list? But,
so the $30,000.
So I don't want to put that money in and then have the roof have to be all removed or replace carpet, and then all of a sudden we decide to do the work above it. And so to probably do proper sequence to save money and make a decision.
And the problem with the MSBA, Mr. Marapizzi, is they don't want us spending $25,000 on a study. They want to come in, and they just did. They came out in 2005, they came out in 2010, they just came out again. They're assessing all the school buildings in Massachusetts. So they don't want us going out to spending $25,000 to say this needs to be fixed. We would just submit it and say, hey, we think we need a new roof, and then they'll come out, and then they'll pay for at minimum 50% of everything. So why do we want to spend 25 when if we wait, they'll pay $12,500? So there's the timing issue.
And I appreciate you saying that. And I'm not even saying that spend 25. I'm saying we owe it to do the research. And if they need to do the research to help us pay for it, then they need to do the research to help us pay for it. I think Mr. Lesko has a good starting plan here.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Just there's a lot of questions to come.
My question. It's a standing seam metal roof, correct? Now, that company, the manufacturer that manufactures that product, right, they're still in business. And have we brought out the manufacturer's rep to have them look at it, to tell us whether our useful life is gone or not gone, or the recommendations to of either painting it or sealing it, or what are our alternates?
We could do that, but it's only a portion of the problem. I mean, yes, we could bring somebody out and ask them about costs for repair of the roof.
Recommendations, and then we can try to make some intelligent decisions. There's an awful lot of hard feelings about how much money was spent on the elementary school roof, and the fact that the cost per square foot was much more than what the typical repairs were, or re-roofing, and what they paid. And I want to be very cautious as to what we do going down the road and try to figure the thing out before we make get tied into an architect, et cetera, et cetera.
It's one of the, when you go, you know, to some extent, when you go with an MSBA project and MSBA funding, they become the drive. And this is a good discussion because it begs the question, you know, personally, I think the project over Deerfield was a good project. But
the square footage
came in low.
Very,
very specific of what they wanted and how they wanted that done. And yeah, there was some controversy.
The soft costs were substantial compared to what the actual construction was.
But getting
back to this roof.
But it would be the same, Cindy, whether we used MSBA or not. The code determines when the architecture comes in, not the MSBA.
But my question is, so if we do the design study, then we apply, they come out, that design study means nothing.
Right.
They do their own design study if they take us on?
Yes. Yep.
And I'm not, I put that study and the number in there because I knew it was going to generate this kind of discussion, and I think this discussion is really important because there's so many different ways that we can move forward, and we need to give some thought. thought to it. What I don't want to have happen is for us to have a bad storm late this winter or something and have a major failure and have the school say, well, we didn't know there was potential there. And that's what I'm saying. There's potential here. There's a project that one way or the other, we've got to figure out how to do. And I think the answers are beyond what I should be doing with bringing. And I'm not saying Bob's wrong. I can bring a vendor in to look at the roof. But I think the complexity of this entire envelope and the associated insulation and ventilation and a whole bunch of other issues are things that ought to be looked at by somebody with a little more insight than I can bring to them.
So to follow up on that, what are our odds of having them come out and it's a positive move that they're going to take us on? What are our chances? How long did Deerfield have to wait?
A year.
Just a year? So if
we applied in January and the roof went on that summer. So, but now it's a little bit more complicated here because I'm not dealing with a town, I'm dealing with four towns. And I've never done an MSBA project for a regional. So I don't know if that means we've got to go to have four special town meetings to even submit the statement. I have to research all that.
Okay.
You would.
Sorry, Keith. I was just thinking.
When Mr. Lesko came to us last year about the same, just to get a frame of reference, what's the number bigger than this, equal to this, less than? What am I looking at? I would love to say yes on everything, but keeping in mind operating within the budget, what do we look at last year? How does this compare to the requests from last year?
I don't know if I bought. We had a list of projects last year that were very different than these, but they were probably a bit less money than the total in this category. I can.
And then just the second question would be the 2 to 5 year estimate. What would we be looking at? Is this really short compared to what we're looking at the next couple of years? Can we find a balance of what we can do this year and to next year?
Yeah. It's really, you know, it's a huge job trying to bring all of these things together and price them. What I'm showing, I think what you should, the conclusion that you should be drawing, or that at least I draw from looking at the whole list of projects and the magnitude of it all, is that in the next 5 to 7 years, some real thought's gonna have to be given to doing some sort of a renovation here. And if we're moving toward that renovation, it's easier to defer these small individual things. I think the thing that really shows is, you know, the fact that with a small list of yearly projects, it's really easy to come up with $150,000 worth of stuff. And that's way beyond what I can get done with an operating budget here.
And
so
can I just add to that? When Marty first became superintendent, we had a capital committee put together. And here's where we're really hamstrung. Our regional agreement does not address how to assess capital costs to our towns. We have no mechanism to say to the towns, we need $150,000.
That's not true.
It is, Philip.
Just asked.
Wait a minute,
I'm telling you, okay, in other regions, their regional agreement says you assess operating capital. Ours is silent. It doesn't give us the mechanism. So when this came up 3 years ago, Marty and I said, we need to work on our regional agreement. We need to figure out how we're gonna assess the towns, and we need to go start amending the regional agreements. We didn't do anything, nothing happened. That whole capital committee fell apart. The last time we tried to bring capital forward, it became a pick and choose, and the four towns, none of them approved the same project.
Democracy. That's how it works,
so
and that could happen with the capital project too.
So we're never going to get anywhere, Phil. That's why we have to have it addressed in the regional agreement.
The silence is the policy. The silence is the policy. That it does not. You're right. The regional agreement. It's three sentences long that talks about our financial structure, and it just says all monies spent have to be voted on by all four towns, the majority of voters in all four towns. That's
Right.
That's capital, that's ordinary.
No, it's not ordinary, Phil. What I'm telling you is that other regional agreements, I am the only one that sits in a regional meeting that does not have a regional agreement that tells them how to assess their capital costs.
How did we assess capital for the regional media center project, the original one in 1981, and the 1998 one that Mary and I co-chaired? How did we assess the capital costs for the...
All four towns agreed.
That's not what I asked you. I want to know how we assessed the capital. Was it based on enrollment? Was it based on a regional agreement? What was it based? It had to be based on something. Because I've done two large. This was $23 million the last time when we did this place in 1998. We assessed that out somehow.
They're all based, every dollar that we spend as a region is based on the student formula. Whether it's ordinary or
capital. But that's not in the regional agreement.
Yes, it is.
Not for capital, it's not.
To answer Billy's question, we have to go back and do a little research to see how the computations were done, because Don Scott came up, I think he was the, was he there, or was Dr. Spreadsheet there?
98? That's 18 years, I don't know. I can't remember.
Spreadsheet? You never done with Dr. Spreadsheet?
Anyway.
So, yeah, most of us aren't going to know that, but I do agree that there needs to be some kind of a committee. It shouldn't be at the large side of here, with all towns represented, so that we can, if we're making a decision to apply to MSBA or anywhere else, that
we had a capital
committee. We're reaching across the aisles to figure out how to get it approved.
What Patty seeks is a shortcut. It is, because you want a shortcut so that somehow maybe we can get a capital budget approved with only three of the four. Or somehow without all the voters approving.
That's not what I'm saying.
That's not what you said.
What I'm saying is, if Bob came to us this year and says, I want to do these four projects, every year, like we did with the debt, the towns would get assessed an amount of money to cover those four projects. Period. And only when we went to build a big building, like you're saying, then we would go to the four towns. But there should be some mechanism for us to do capital repairs within a certain dollar amount that just gets assessed through the assessment vehicle. That's what every other regional has.
That's a shortcut. That deprives the voters of the direct choice to spend their money. And that's what people are not going to give up. They have that now. They're not going to go to a plan where their elected people vote their budget for them when they have the ability to say yes or no right now on their own.
Okay, I'd like to thank you, Bob, for bringing this to us. I'd like to thank you for bringing this to us.
I have one more question before we get through.
Do you want me
to...
No,
I was just trying to break the little thread here. I think that we have a lot of work ahead of us, and as Bob has said, we don't have to spend this money. Sounds like it has generated, I don't know if you knew this much conversation, but perhaps we should look into that. I do know we need to look into the regional agreement. We've talked about that before. We talked about that when Lynn came on.
Yep.
So I do think we have to do that, but I don't think we have to get into that kind of a discussion tonight. Okay. So I'm just going to ask you to continue forward so we can get the whole grasp of things.
All right.
But not in any way saying yay or nay, just saying let's finish the list, okay?
The manhole, you know, some of our parking lots, or all of our parking lots are getting to a point where we're going to have to consider some major work. We've just got some expensive repairs that need to be done. We've got a couple of manholes that are pretty much caving in. We've got a very deep depression over on the south side of the building, on the western end of the parking lot, and then we've got a section where there's a drain in the back of the building between the garage and the building, and I think we need to bring somebody in to rebuild those structures and pave over. We've got a problem with the flat roof around the air handling unit. It serves the boys' locker room. I've had a roofer in there six times if I've had them in once, and I have been unable to patch it. So I think what we need to do is cut around that air handler and replace a section of the PVC flat roof in order to stop that leak. We mow probably 20 plus acres with our equipment that we have here that we maintain. Facility, you know, we've got all of the ball fields here at Frontier. We do Herlihy, and we've been doing Deerfield Elementary. we have, what I'd like to do is buy one tractor that I think will replace two. We've got an old Massey Ferguson that's in pretty bad shape. We haven't been using it much. We've got a smaller John Deere diesel that does a ton of our mowing. I'd like to buy a tractor that's mid-range. I want to buy the smallest tractor that I can get with a three-point hitch that will allow us to have a good maneuverable piece of equipment that can do some mowing and have some attachments on it, like a brush and some other items. It's an expensive replacement. And then the last item that's on there is just replacing a washer and a dryer. We've got two sets of washer and dryers in this building. One's in the kitchen, one's in the old family consumer lab. I don't like to let people use one for the other because of the usage. The ones in the kitchen shouldn't have some of the material that are going to the other ones in here, so they really ought. And, you know, there's a couple of things this year that aren't on the list that I talked with Darius this morning. I mean, two things that just missed my putting them on this list today are, we've been trying to figure out the last couple of years what to do with the football goalposts. They look terrible, and it ain't as easy as putting a ladder up against them and painting them. We really need to get somebody in here to drop them with a crane and then sand them down and repaint them and pick them back up. And by the time you do that, you've spent 80% of the cost of a new set of football goalposts. So, you know, we're going to have to figure out at some point what to do with those. And very similar to that, we've got a batting cage that goes up every single year in our gym. And there's a huge issue with assembling that thing. And it, in my opinion, it's a safety issue. It's an accident waiting for something to happen. Somebody's going to get hurt putting that up or taking it down. Most of the newer batting cages that you see in high schools are set up on a motorized system that just pulls them up out of the way when you're not supposed to, and you're done. And something else that was, later on in the discussion, we'll talk about the fact that, you know, we tacked something on just a week ago that we had a problem with. I kind of warned Lynn that there's a piece of equipment in the kitchen that was about to fail. And it's, all our schools are about the same age. Most of them have a steamer in them. It's a small gas boiler that feeds a steamer and a kitchen. And the gas boilers in those are wearing out. We lost the one in Deerfield and replaced it last summer. The one in Sutherland is struggling. I just got a call three weeks ago from the people in the kitchen. We had somebody in look at that boiler. They said there's a small leak in it. It might last 6 months. It might last a year. It lasted 6 hours. Patty's found me money, and we're going to replace that. But it's those kinds of expenditures. I think what I'm really showing here is none of these in and of itself is a capital expenditure. But when you add up a bunch of things, it really makes sense to do and draw a line below it, it's a lot of money. And people sometimes feel like we're not doing anything because these projects sit on the list year after year.
On a tractor?
Yes.
Okay, have we looked into bidding it out, having that mowing done by a contractor as to what that would cost us annually?
We could, but I'll
it may cost us more, but I'm just asking a question out loud.
You know, I have not done that, but what I will say to you is Deerfield was spending a good amount of money paying somebody to mow it, and we picked it up and are mowing it for us, and the cost of what we're spending on mowing it isn't probably, it's less than half of what we were paying to have somebody mow it. And plus, Our athletic teams are very, very particular. I want to say fussy, but I'll say particular. About the mowing we do and the quality of the field and hiring somebody. You know, most of your local people that mow are not going to do
But you got 25,000, and I assume that machine will last 10 years?
The one we have has lasted 10 years.
That's my point. Maybe it's 2,500 bucks a year for the machine.
Actually, the one that we have has lasted almost 18 years.
Now it's a John Deere also?
Yeah, it's a John Deere diesel.
Would you buy a diesel again?
I think we would, yeah. The only real issue that I have with diesel, and I've got the money to resolve that now, is there's no good place to get our vehicles to get the diesel from, so we're going with a pickup and cans, picking it up, and...
Hey, we got a whole tank in the ground we can use.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Not without getting in trouble with the state.
Well.
But, you know, what we're going to do is we're either going to put a 275-gallon oil tank that we fill with diesel in the garage, or we're going to put a portable tank in the new pickup we have, which, thank you all, has been a godsend. It's a beautiful piece of equipment.
I think Bob's idea, I don't know if you meant to say that, but the $2,500 a year for 10, like, to lease these things or to do different types of creative financing for these so that you wouldn't have to have a 25,000 budget hit. You could do 2,500 a year for 10 years and get a new tractor and keep it.
Yeah.
That those...
I'd be willing, you know, if
Bob doesn't care, just get him the equipment.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. That's the way to go on stuff like this.
There may be a way we can lease it, yep.
Okay, so I'm not hearing any conversation about anything more than the upgrades. So right now, we're being asked to vote on to approve the long-range facilities plan. So we could take and table just the 25,000 off until maybe next month. I know that you're very busy. People are trying to move people in here, but get a better timeline maybe from Patty as to what it would take to do her part for the building authority. Because you said that getting that.
But to be honest with you, Cindy, there's no way I could have it for. I'm working on budgets.
Okay.
I can't do that.
So what is a timeline there? Because we are obviously we can't get anywhere here tonight. So we have to have some kind of a plan. So if the plan is that we can't get to it for several months, then let's go for it and do the study. Because we're just pushing it off another year, and what else is gonna come up?
Well, we can vote on the package of 152.9, and if we something with the $25,000, we do something different, it doesn't mean we have to spend it.
Well, where are you gonna get the $152,000?
Excess and efficiency.
There's only $75,000.
When they certify your...
What's the stabilization?
What you had left over.
Nothing. We used it to do the move.
So before we vote on spending money, what kind of money do we have to spend?
Right now, all we have is $75,000 in the E&D.
But the projected surplus...
We can't spend that until it's certified.
We're not going to spend it. The point is we're trying to plan what we think is going to be available.
Can we vote that we want this as a wish list pending budgetary issues?
Yes, but my question is, if it's going to take several months to put this before the building authority, then I think we should go forward with the study. If it's going to be something with the next few months, but it doesn't sound like it is because we're coming into budget, that's fine, but we're just pushing this off again and then people are going to forget about it, so maybe we should spend the money.
But the study money, right, is going to be a waste of money if the school building people come in and take it over, because they're going to do their own study.
Can you, we had this, a little bit of this discussion at the budget subcommittee meeting at 5:30. Can you guys hold your water for a month? Let the budget subcommittee meet once or twice, because I had some ideas on how we, before I even saw this list, on how we handled some of these things in terms of whether they're part of the operating budget, whether they should be standalone articles. Can you give us, at least January 5th, and probably again after that before, this committee meets again on the 24th, can you give us that long to kick this thing around?
Do you want the whole list?
No.
Just that?
Yeah.
Okay, so.
I don't think there's anything, I personally don't think there's anything to vote on. You don't have any money, you don't have a funding source. You've got, Bob's done yeoman's work, and this is the stuff that I was talking about with you guys earlier. This is the stuff that I wanted to see. So just give us that lock to pick and choose. Maybe we put some of this goes into a
emergency repair to the roof like Deerfield's was, maybe some of it goes on a separate article on town meeting. You don't put this kind of stuff in a cap, in an operating budget, because it falsely inflates the operating budget for years to come. So you pick out what's going to stand alone, put it on a separate article by itself, but let the four of us
Thank you.
So moved.
Thank you.
So we're going to table?
So we will table that, or we can refer it to subcommittee.
Don't misunderstand me. I'm not putting you off. I'm trying to get there faster.
I hear you.
We're going to table and refer.
If anybody's interested, I did find the list of projects that we funded last year, about $115,000 worth of similar things, and I'll be glad to share that with anybody.
$37,000 difference.
Can you, in between, also see if you can get a hold of the manufacturer standing seam to see whether somebody can actually come out and take a look as
if I can figure out who the man, you know, I've got pretty good construction records here from the 98 renovation. I don't have a lot of stuff from
they may not even be in business, Bob, anymore.
Well, standing seam, they still advertise the standing seam, but roofs all over, Bob.
Well, yeah, I can get somebody out here that works on standing seam roofs. I'm not sure I can get,
but I thought that's a trait. That's a trait.
Yeah, the trade being, I mean, you have to get the person who sold it to us, and maybe it'd be out of business.
Yeah, well.
Is the warranty still in effect?
There's no warranty. What I'm looking for on this roof is a recommendation from somebody that really understands the construction of it as to whether we want to try to spend some money to repair and replace it, repair it and upgrade it, or whether we should be thinking about budgeting for totally replacing.
Well, the other thing is, if we're going to replace the roof, and we knew the whole thing as to whether or not it's going to be cost effective to put the solar on it, because it's got that exposure.
I don't disagree.
MSBA won't pay for that. We just went through that.
But that's why I think we want either MSBA or a consultant to look at this and consider all of those bigger options, rather than having a roofer come out here and say, we can paint it with this junk and it'll give you another 2 years.
But Bob, remember, MSBA would not pay for solar on the roof, and they did not recommend it either.
And I don't think we need to talk further about that, whether or not they do. I think that we have a great idea with the budget subcommittee to take a closer look at it, and then.
Bob, the one question that I had is, it was the paint, is there any, it was the manhole repair, is that anything to do with the front entrance coming in, just that first 10 feet of the driveway of the front entrance when?
Yes.
Does that have to do with that?
A couple of places where it's just.
Wow, is that bad?
You know, there's structures in there.
It does make you slow down, but we're going to have to start.
It's a reverse speed bump.
Subsidizing ball joints and tie rods for our students' vehicles.
It's convex aesthetic, I gave
you. Shut the parking lot.
I wanted by coming here with this, and that is, I got your attention about some things that I think need to be thought about.
Okay, so we're going to keep you getting our attention, because we're going to jump from A to D. And because this is Bob, and then we'll actually let you go home.
Yeah.
Solar net metering credit purchase evaluation.
Okay, that's another one that, and it goes to what Bob said. We, a couple of years ago, hired someone who did a bunch of work for the towns with the Siemens work, where we put an energy management system in Deerfield and Sunderland. She also has a great deal of experience with what's going on in the local solar industry. I'm getting probably 3 calls a week from people that are saying, if you're not putting solar on your building right now, you ought to be looking into purchasing net metering credits. Basically, if we want to get the advantages of solar PV here at the high school, we've either got to put in our own array, or we can buy into one of these big, huge projects that are going on, like out in Holyoke, and we can get pretty much the same advantages without having it on the roof here. But it's a complex economic calculation as to whether we want to buy the net metering credits, or whether we want to look very seriously into adding some sort of a solar array here on the high school, or whether we want to bide our time. what people are telling me is there's tax credits available now that aren't going to be around in another year. And we're not going to put together a solar project to go on this building in less than a year. So I think it's a worthwhile investment to have Beth take another look at the market and tell us whether I ought to call one of these salesmen that's calling me every day and say, yes, we're interested.
So I do have just a question to start. Have you been in touch with the town of Deerfield's Energy Committee to ask, you know, their recommendation on this? I don't know if the other towns also have an energy committee, but, you know, there is a committee that would, that's looking at townwide.
I think all of the towns independently are struggling with the same thing. And a lot of the towns are putting, trying to put together solar projects with varying results. I mean, Sunderland right now has got one going.
Yes.
And it's a good project. Yes, I could call the towns and they would pretty much probably tell me that they're struggling with the same thing I am. Should we try to develop our own or should we try to buy into, you know, one of these? I think putting solar collectors here on the high school for both political reasons and practical reasons would be very difficult. But it's worth, you know,
I don't think that's a big decision down the line. It just, even the solar metering credits, that's a smaller decision, and we could know, you know, as the town of Deerfield from the energy committee, do they have a recommendation?
Yep.
You know,
yes, I can call them. I would almost say that they're going to say, yeah, it's a good idea, but you've got to look into the financial part of it. Because once we buy the net metering credits, we're to some extent locking ourselves out of the market for putting panels on for a few years. Because you can't kind of double dip on those credits right now. Maybe in 10 years from now, something else will happen. So if we bought net metering credits now, we could still do a project. All I'm saying is I'm hearing there's a window of opportunity that's something in the next 6 months to a year where we either make a decision to buy net metering credits or we just stand pat where we are and see what happens.
Bob, I'm a little confused when you're talking about tax credits because we don't pay taxes. So are you saying they're purchase discounts?
I don't think they're not taxed. They're
people that invest and they get tax credits.
Essentially, by getting these net metering credits, what we're doing is we're buying into the solar project and we're going to get reduced. It's not going to reduce our taxes. It's going to reduce the cost of our electricity.
Right, but how could we double dip on a tax credit if we're not getting them?
Well, the net metering, I'm not saying the tax credits. I believe the net metering credits are I don't know precisely.
All right.
But my understanding is once we lock into them, it's not something that
you go one way or the other. You don't do both. Got it.
Okay. And again, it's a pretty complicated market out there, and I don't understand all of it.
If we buy the net metering credits, are we going to have to come up with a great big capital contribution to buy it up front?
No.
And it's just going to be
I don't believe we're going to have to pay anything.
We're going to
have to commit to something.
For like 25 to 50 years.
I don't think that comment is helpful for this committee. I think
If you're thinking about 25 or 50 years, and we're going to spend $5,500 and then to do this little study, and then it's going to come back and say, well, it's probably not going to meet the political test in the area and what have you, so maybe we're going to waste the $5,500. I don't know enough about it.
And
so that's why I'm asking some of the questions.
And I think that's why I'm asking for a recommendation from an energy committee.
I'll call and ask. I'm not sure what I'll get, but I'll be glad to call.
Who's the person you're having asked? Who's Beth?
Beth Carmichael. She runs a program. She runs a company. She's a consultant. She runs a company called Beacon. She's the one that put together the solar, the project that's happening in Sunderland right now.
We used her about 4 years ago.
Yeah, she was
She put out a bid for us 4 years ago, but we didn't get any bites because there were no new arrays coming online for us to get the credits from. So we had just missed the market from the last set of arrays that went up. Now the next set of arrays are coming online now. So this would be the next time to test the market. But we did walk away with nothing last time.
So I think it might be useful to invite Beth here. I mean, I'm just listening to him. That sounds like a request for support from the committee for this. And
I think that's a great suggestion to have Beth come here. Because she's the one that can tell you what we'd get out of this.
Let's have her come.
But I also...
Second.
No, he was first.
Oh, sorry. Thank you, Bob.
Correct me if I'm wrong. Did you say that the company with the new roof, they wouldn't support a new roof if we're going to put solar on it?
The MSB wouldn't pay for it.
Wouldn't pay for what?
The solar panels.
Oh.
Nor did the architect recommend putting them up there. The MSBA is not a fan of putting the solar arrays on roofs, on school roofs.
What's different, school roofs and a house roof?
There's a big difference. There's a lot of different codes. There's more code regarding a school roof or a house.
Whether it's a school roof or it's a house roof, there are lots of maintenance issues related to solar panels on the roof. And there's
versus the ground.
Yeah.
Versus like
the ground. Right. We don't have a lot of land out here to put a ground brick.
No, we don't.
Judy?
I just want to say, good idea, Phil. But I also agree with Phil to say, you know, to engage the Energy Commission. They might not want to participate in the process, but at least to reach out and see if they have some input or want to come to the meeting where the Beacon Energy person is going to be here to talk about it so we can just initiate the process together rather than just do it on our own.
If it's helpful, again, I'm sure Beth would be glad to come here and talk to you some about the market at one of your meetings.
Well, we've got January 24th.
I can arrange for her to come out and talk about it, and she can tell you, she'll be able to tell you what a lot of the local towns are doing, because she's kind of been the go-to consultant for all of the towns.
She did the Sunderland project.
So are we going to vote on $5,500 or are we going to table
that? We're going to table this. We're getting pretty good here. Two tables. So for three. The potential kitchen equipment failure is what you...
That's a moot point. It failed and Patty found me the money, so...
Oh.
We saved that.
Well, it
Patty,
wasn't even set up
some,
to...
Thank you, Patty. Some money?
Mm-hmm. I wanted
to
table
some money?
That.
I got a bunch of stuff.
Okay, so...
A couple of hips, a knee.
You're going to see if you can get her to come out to our January meeting and supply some information, and we'll go forth from there. Okay. Thank you for all of the information that you brought tonight. We're a tough group.
Bring a lunch to all of your
time. I know.
Thank you so much, Bob. Thank you.
Thanks, Bob.
Okay, so we're going to go backwards a little bit to our Student Advisory Council member who came. So just going to kind of deviate over here. Hi.
Hi. I won't take too much time, but so I don't know if the last person who came to this council.
Excuse me.
Can you tell us who you are?
Yeah,
I usually do. Yes. This is.
I'm so sorry.
No, you're fine. You're fine.
You're fine.
You're fine. I'm bad. This is Angela South. She's from our student advisory.
Welcome, Angela.
Thank you.
And from Conway.
Yeah.
What's your last name, Angela?
Self.
Osco?
Self.
S-E-L-F.
Self.
Self.
Selfie.
Herself.
S-E-L-F.
Thank you.
So one of our major goals this year is that we feel like there's a big disconnect between the high school and the middle school, and we hope that we can bridge this more and make it seem more like a more cohesive community. So we have created an application for eighth graders to apply to be on the student council so that they feel like they're involved more in the community. And we have 11 new middle schoolers on our student council. And we're in the process of reviewing seventh grade applications at the moment. We have had this project to do a Dakin Animal Shelter holiday drive, and we're extending it to the middle school so that they can feel like they're contributing a little bit during the holidays. And so I think you guys might know that our big project is Field Day in the spring, which was a huge success last year. So we've started selling magnets so that we can start to prepare in December so we're not rushed during the spring trying to find funds to do this sort of thing. And it's going going really well so far. Are there any questions or?
Is that the day that they let you have two periods?
Yeah.
Is that the day that I had a huge issue with that they call it a day?
It should be a field hour. You want it to be longer.
I want you to work on that.
All right.
But that's all we have right now. I know it's kind of short, but is there anything else?
Oh, that's excellent.
I think you should show the thing you're selling because maybe you can sell one.
Oh, yeah, we're just selling these.
Oh, those are right.
Yeah.
You should have bought some. We would have bought some.
How much are they and how can they get some?
They're $5 and they're available in the main office.
Is there any incentives for the students to sell them or is it just a sell them thing?
The money goes to their project. What's the incentive?
Right, but so if she was to sell one, two, three.
If she was to sell one to everyone, I'd get her a tardy to free school.
There you go.
Oh, that's totally
worth it. January, everybody bring their $5 for January. We'll buy one.
All right. Thank you.
Excellent.
Guys.
Thank you so much.
Excellent presentation. Really well spoken. I never experienced this part.
What did you expect from a cowboy girl? Come on. Okay. We're going to let her go back because it takes a while to get home.
She's not going to walk.
Thank you. Okay, we'll pop back up to the bus driver training procedures. I don't know if anybody got a chance to look it over, but that was very well written.
That came right from the manual. So a couple of school committees had asked about our bus safety. So I spoke to Grifto, who is our transportation provider. All school bus drivers are required to get 60 hours of instructional training to get their initial licensure. That's been in place since June of 2010. And then annually, they are required to do 8 additional hours. They have to get their license renewed every year. So every year before they get renewed, they have to show that they did an additional 8 hours of safety training. GRIPCO has 2 certified trainers on staff that take care of those 8 hours. And in addition to that, we as the district provide to our drivers curriculum training in anti-bullying and medical emergency, like how to administer an EpiPen and simple safety things like that. This past Friday, for the first time, the Massachusetts State Police met with our drivers here at Frontier Regional and gave them a seminar on school bus security. So I just gave you the Mass General Law, what they're trained to do, and then giving you the updates of what we provide them as.
So
any
questions? I think like this came up, the reason that the bus safety committee came up for a lot of people is obviously the horrible events in
Plainfield.
And it was just a few years ago that an incident in Amherst took place. And incident is a really tame word for these types of things. But I remember when the Amherst thing came and it's amazing how common these are, like across our country and across our state, and how we don't advocate for like basic safety things like seat belts and buses, and then a lot of states require that, but we don't. But like the thing that came out that I remember reading was that the reason that so many of these types of things happen, that like where the bus driver that drives that same route knows that route, like when something like that happens, that it's the same thing that the TSA bomb detectors at the airports can never catch the bombs that they bring past the thing. And it's the repetition in them, and that what they recommend is that bus drivers vary their routes and that they don't get bored with the same routes. And I was wondering whether we can discuss with GRIPCO a policy where the bus drivers don't drive the same route, and with that we make sure that they're getting rotated so that they don't get bored with the route. Not that a new route every day would be that much more exciting for them, but that's a basic safety thing that we don't really look at, just driver boredom.
It's a very good suggestion. I will tell you that they did change drivers in Sunderland, and there was quite people really wanted the other driver back. So they switched drivers, and then they had to, they switched him back because the drivers actually know the kids, know the families, are more comfortable, they have relationships with the parents if they come to the bus, that kind of thing. So while it's a good idea because of that, you know, familiarity, it breeds content, you know, it can go both ways. So you're so used to it that you're not looking for something different. And yet, on the other hand, you are familiar with the kids, the families, the homes, the stops. And unfortunately, what happened up north a couple weeks back in October, just a windy day, something got caught in the door. She was done, she was free, got caught in the door, and just a horrific tragedy. I think being a little more, just a tad slower, you know, just slowing down and being more present. But it is hard when you switch out drivers with, because they all become attached. It's like switching teachers at the beginning of the year, that sort of thing.
I think it's a good suggestion, but she's, same thing. When my daughter was at that age, you know, like saying hi to them, you like seeing them. All of a sudden, you've got different bus drivers showing up. They don't know the kids. You start to get wiggy as a parent. But
I may have had to substitute bus drivers. They'll go flying past my house, and my kids will be on the bus, and I got to go chase them down.
Yeah. You're right. They don't even
see. They don't even know where to stop.
Well, so, it makes it more difficult because we're basically door-to-door and there wasn't bus stops.
Right.
So that it does make
right,
it
if
more,
a bus stop,
it makes it
that
even more difficult.
But,
right. Right.
You know, where I live, right. It's just, it's the house and they
so
don't know where to stop.
That we're working on. So we, no, I'm serious. We actually, we just got a software and I'm going to be able to give each bus driver the actual, you need to stop at this address and this address because we will know where our kids are on the maps.
I think just reviewing this, and it sounds like they review it, but it's nice for us to know that they do it. I don't know how much more. Did you read this? Because it's pretty good. If they're actually implementing this, that's the second problem. If they are doing all of this, then this covers it all.
It's like pretty good, but at the same, like I was reading it and I was thinking, boy, does this really address the causes, the root causes of either of the fatal incidents in our area in the past few years. And I was like, I don't know if it really does.
You can only do so much.
The other thing was that, Patty, when did you add the Director of Transportation to your title?
It came with the original job.
Did it?
Yeah.
Oh, yes.
Yeah, most
of
the managers
are. You don't sign it in all your, it's not in your signature line in your emails. You gotta add it.
I can't fit. It probably can't fit.
It probably can't fit.
It comes under Business Services.
Okay.
I remember, and Don hated that.
But I love it.
He did.
Hated that part of his job.
And I just love it.
Okay, so moving along, if there's no further questions, the Frontier Library Media Center roof envelope.
We talked about that.
Yeah. Oh, that you're going to.
Same difference.
Okay. All right, but that means we're tabling that also. Well, we are just 100% here. Okay, reports. Collaborative is not here tonight. Business principal.
So, I mean, so I'll kind of go through my reports pretty straightforward of announcements of things that mostly that have happened. We had our fall production of The Odd Couple in November there, and it was a wonderful production since our last meeting. And they did a great show, and now we're moving on to a musical production of Guys and Dolls, and we haven't had a musical here in quite some time. I'm not sure if there has been one here since I've been here. So we're looking forward to that as our next step within the drama. Our winter concerts were last week, both the middle school and high school concerts, and I was able to attend those both, and they were outstanding. I don't know if anybody else here was at any of those, but they really did a wonderful job, students and directors alike, both Max Sherrill and Denise Sittler, to run those programs. Our school's match wits team had their match this past Saturday. It hasn't been televised yet. But as I say, I'm smiling. We went against a charter school in North Adams, and I want to thank Stacey Chapley, who has put together this team who is on a several-year winning streak here. I don't know, I'm not announcing whether they won or lost because you'll have to tune in to see, but I hear it's a good one.
When is it advertised? When is it?
I think it's in February or March. I'll get that around the next month. Okay. It's not for a while.
It's in post-production.
Yes, they have, to edit all the...
That's right.
Yankee Candle has once again invited us to their gift, their annual community gift-giving presentation, which is on Monday. Again, we're always thankful for our generous community businesses. I mean, Yankee Candle gave us $20,000 last year, so I hope to report such a wonderful gift this year. And be obviously, with the money goes to scholarships to our students. And what's nice about that presentation, for those of you who are new, is that the students come back, those who can get out of college early. I don't think UMass gets out to the 23rd this year, but they come back and they attend that morning, they say hello and they say how they're doing and such. They give a little report on their scholarships. That's a wonderful morning.
Could I ask you a question about that? Do you know whether if we had a foundation and Yankee Candle could get a tax deduction, whether they would give substantially more than $20,000, or whether they would...
You'd have to ask. They have a pretty...
can you ask?
They have an organized... They have a very organized... if you're ever looking for donations from them, they have a pretty scripted how they give money and the way they... and what they're looking for. So they have a pretty smooth operation on that. So, I mean, is... You can reach
they
out
get
to
the
their...
deduction anyway.
What's that?
They get the deduction anyway. They give it to Frontier, they get the deduction.
Yeah, and then they also give to the towns as well. And they rotate between Deerfield and Waitley, where their two facilities are, and they give to the they give to fire, ambulance, and police, and they rotate between each one of the units, so to speak, between each town going back and forth. So, speaking of graduates there, later that week, we're trying something kind of a fun thing this year. Around the day before break, we always get a lot of kids returning, and so we try to even formalize, and instead of just maybe they'll drop by, we ask them to swing by. And so we send out postcards to them right before Thanksgiving break to let the class of 2016, and we ask them to come on the 23rd that morning. We're going to do a coffee and kind of chat and social and kind of catch up. And then at 10 o'clock, we're going to do a more formal, ask them questions of how they're doing, what was good about their experience here, where can we improve, just kind of more of it's kind of it's anecdotal kind of information, but it's good to check in with kids. It's good for the community to have some of the kids come back and kind of meet with their teachers and see how things are going. So it's kind of a, it's a half day. It's one of those crazy days anyway, so we're kind of shutting down the library and doing that with that. The regular class is going on, but we're going to have the seniors come at 10 o'clock for that second period of student. So we've done it informally, and we try to formalize a few times in the past. Allison has helped with that as well, putting those, get those kids come back. So that's a new fun thing. And then the last thing is, as you heard from when Louise and Sarah talked about, grades 3-8 are going to the online testing this year, or at least we're going to the online testing. We've kind of avoided PARC in the past, which was a good decision. But right now we're putting together practice lessons for, not lessons, tests for the kids who are taking the test on the computer, because that's something new. And the where that kind of comes to your level is just an FYI, and the community level is, in the past, we've done a delayed opening for MCAS. Well, this year's ELA, the 7th and 8th grade, is at a different time than the 10th grade. So we used to be able to test the whole school at once. We would take part of the day off because we were using so many of the faculty members, because it was good just to shut things down. This year, I don't feel I can justify that because middle school's in one testing window and high school's in another testing window. So we're going to have to shut down parts of the building rather than shutting down the school and kind of getting out of the way for one morning for a couple hours that we've done in the past. So we're putting that together as well for the ELA. Math is in the same window, so we're going to see how it goes to figure out if we need to shut down for math. The nice part about it was nice getting the three grades in here and having other students be, you know, 2 hour, kind of a 2 hour delay, and really be able to concentrate and put all our resources to it instead of having to scramble about. So we'll see how it goes. And then again, I think I said in there that we are also going to teach the kids how to take the test on the computer. It's a new skill, but as you know, we've gone to that one-to-one model with Chromebooks in the middle school, so they've been on them daily, so they're pretty apt at them, so there is no real coincidence that that's our planning here, but we know that they're going that direction. So one of the things we're also looking at is Chromebooks are a smaller screen, and how to take a test with a smaller screen, and whether or not we have to get mice for them. or do we need to go to a larger screen in the library for the middle school testing, like the library? So we're going to try to figure that out. So
can you dock a Chromebook?
What's that?
Can you, like, you know, like with my laptop, I can dock it to a bigger screen. Can you do that with Chromebooks?
You probably can, yeah, but we don't have the screens. All of the screens we have are connected to computers. So we do. I mean, you got to remember, we have this computer lab looking around here. It's about two class sizes worth. We have three other computer labs that could house testing. So we could do it. It would just turn into a different kind of scheduling thing, whereas Chromebooks, we could do everybody all at once in one kind of period. And we may think that, of course, we want the bigger screen of taking a test, but, I mean, the kids are walking around typing on these things all day. The small screen doesn't seem to be a problem. So we're going to test it out to see how they do and get their input on it as well. So
my experience is the Chromebooks are fine. The Chromebooks are fine. They're very used to them, and they carry them around all day. The more we move towards one-to-one as the grades go up, the middle school's really heavy into them now. It'll be like talking on the telephone. That'll be adjusted.
That's where we think too. We're gonna take a look at it anyways, because we don't want technology to get in the way of results, you know, and the kids accessing the test.
My students take OSHA online, and they all use Chromebooks. And the only issue we've had is they aren't charged because they haven't been plugged in correctly, or they boot into them and they shut down. So it's more the technical end of it, not the. They have never complained about the screen or they are very fast. With their fingers, very fast. They all type very well too. So that may be something.
I wouldn't think they would need to use
like
you said.
Either.
This is probably too big for them.
Yeah.
Of course,
great. They're going with the watches now.
Right? That's right. Thank you, sir. And superintendent's report.
And I'll be very quick. So going down the list. The Odd Couple was excellent. I enjoyed it. The two winter concerts, I couldn't believe what Max and Denise got out of the middle school. It was wonderful. And the high school was awesome. Just awesome. Just such talent. And I sat with Bill and his wife. And it was really just wonderful. I can't speak enough to the talent and the compassion and the quality of our students and when they're getting involved. I'm looking forward to Guys and Dolls. Yankee Candle is coming and I'll be there. And the MCAS, I did speak to that earlier as well. We're going online. We'll be held harmless, but we'll learn a lot while we're doing it. The other two things, Patty talked about the bus procedures the bus drivers go through. We are looking at a curriculum, particularly for our pre-K to 6, but we may bring it into the middle school, just about how we can help students understand how to be better passengers in the bus. We talked a little bit about switching drivers and drivers knowing the route. The hard thing is if you're a driver and you've got 30 kids and they're all wiggly behind you, or as they get older, they're doing, you know, it's really hard to have that unstructured time with those kids sitting behind you while you're driving and you've got your life in their hands. So we do want to get out the word that passengers have a responsibility to, students have a responsibility to behave, that it is a privilege to be on the bus. And so we do want to work on that. We will be getting that kind of information out. And lastly, the move, we're excited. It's coming along. We're packed. I'm packed. I'm ready. And Darius is waiting for us.
No, I'm still working. Not that Lynn's not. I didn't mean it that way. But I'm still working on the stuff in my office. I can't pack it.
Daddy needs some boxes. I'll bring you some boxes.
No, I've got the boxes.
But we, the office, the movers are coming Friday the 23rd and Monday the 26th. And the office personnel will not be there. I will be there and with Bob Lesko, and we'll be orchestrating the move of the furniture and the boxes, and they're all identified a certain way. And we'll be here during the week of the 27th to the 30th. And just sort of getting set, but we're semi-operational, but we'll be open to the public on January 3rd when the students come back to school. So, and hopefully our next meeting, we will take a quick tour of the, our new pad down here, our new digs. So that's all I have for tonight. Thank you.
Move to adjourn.
All those in favor? I think it's unanimous.